In 2012, when she was just 16, Janelle Tan won the Sanofi Biogenius Challenge in Canada. She discovered anti-aging properties in tree pulp or something along those lines, and something it sounds like I might be able to make use of. And she's with us today on Textination. Welcome, Janelle.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, today she's a senior at Princeton University, and we're right nearby having coffee, studying microbiology. Welcome to Textination, and congratulations on all that you've achieved so far.
Thank you very much.
Now, you've also recently spoken to the Congress of Future Medical Leaders, where you are a mentor as well, is that correct?
Yes, so I've been speaking there for about 3 or 4 years at their conferences.
What really brought us here for a visit is your YouTube channel with the National Leadership Academies. Now, describe what that's all about.
So the National Leadership Academies was essentially created, as I understand, to hold these conferences that are supposed to be this place to bring together lots of like-minded, very highly accomplished high school students that have been nominated by their teachers and other people in their schools. And essentially, they're there to be inspired by some of the top minds in medical fields. So this could be physician scientists, this could be different kinds of doctors. They also have the chance to talk to a lot of patients. So one of the really cool speakers that comes is one of the first recipients of a full face transplant. So she comes and talks about the sort of impact that medicine has had on her life. And so it's sort of supposed to give them inspiration to work hard and do well and strive for the future and what they might do there, but also currently where they are to spark ideas for what they could be doing right where they are, and also to create friendships that they could use to collaborate with different people their age to see what they could do with their interests and talents at that point in time.
Well, how did it come about, the idea of you creating this channel and participating in this, and tell us what people are going to find on this channel?
So one of the things that I do, or all the speakers do, is we go out and we talk to students for about 3 or 4 hours during their lunch breaks and their dinner breaks. And I notice that I start to get a lot of occurring questions, reoccurring questions, things about, you know, how did you get into Princeton? Or what is it like going to an Ivy League school? Or what can I do right now with the talents and resources I have to get to that level? Or what did you feel like when I was your age?
And this is aimed primarily at high school students, right?
Yes, that's correct. So these were high school students coming up to me and asking me all these questions. And I was sort of giving the same answers over and over again to different people. And I realized it'd be really helpful to have a resource where they could actually talk directly to students going to Princeton and other Ivy Leagues about what the experience was like and get all their questions answered. So that's what sparked the idea for having this video series. So essentially what it is, it's pretty informal. I just sat down with a number of my friends that I thought came from different areas. So one does startups and entrepreneurship, another one is definitely going to medical school and wants to be a doctor, another one is interested in sociology and social work. And so I sat down with people from different disciplines at Princeton who I thought were very inspiring and had a lot to share, and essentially asked them the questions that I was getting from these high school students to see the different kinds of answers that they would get.
Now, you're a really busy person. You've been somebody studying microbiology at Princeton. That alone would be more than enough for anyone, but how do you make the time to do this, and why are you making the time to do it?
So I think back to when I was a high school student. I was in a public school in Canada, and so I didn't have access to a lot of the same resources that a lot of counterparts at Princeton honestly do at private schools or with programs there that sort of coach you into how to get into the Ivy League. And so my mom and I really relied upon internet resources, on articles that we would read, on books that people would write. And so it is really important to me that there's equal access to these types of information and how to get to the schools. Education really is...
Very often people are paying a lot of money to try to get information like
this. Exactly.
And you decided to democratize this, so to speak?
In a way, yes. I think it's important that it isn't just based on connections and who you know, that you can access this sort of information, regardless of where you are or how much you can pay for it. And what I also found was that education is one of the biggest sort of like ladders up in society. In an increasingly unequal society, education is the way that you can sort of change or like move up And so it's important to also make that access to education itself more equal. And so that was sort of the underlying reason for that. It also, I saw it very much as an extension of what the Congress does, which is provide mentorship to these students. And I wanted that mentorship to extend not just to people who could come to the conferences, but people who are part of the much larger network of this National Leadership Academies.
So it's typically a one-to-one kind of thing, the mentorship.
Not necessarily. It's speakers, and then they have a chance to sort of speak with the speakers during lunch and dinner breaks. So it's definitely not on a one-to-one basis. But there are a lot of people that are part of the network that don't actually get the chance to go to the conferences. And so this was part of an effort to make them, sort of give them more resources to work with.
So what are some of the more common worries and doubts that you hear about, and how do you try to address them?
Worries and doubts with regards to getting
into college? Well, the students about being intimidated with the whole process of trying to come to a school like Princeton, for instance.
Yes, that's true. So, one of the most common, I would say, the biggest question I often get is, what should I do? I don't have the resources. How can I start working in a lab if you're coming from a science perspective? And so I think my biggest response to this, and I think a theme you'll see throughout the different interviews, is the idea of just taking initiative and doing the best with what you have. That admissions committees look at you in the context in which you exist. And it matters a lot whether you come from like a low-income public school or if you go to a really rich private school, and whether or not you have access to AP classes, whether or not you have access to different kinds of competitions or information.
Obviously, grades are important, but it's more than just grades when you're
talking
about trying to get into an Ivy League school.
Yes. A lot of the people here I found have like, a deep passion for what they do, and often these passions are very unique to them and their personalities. So it isn't that there's one formula for everyone to get in. I think there's this misconception that if you do these certain things and these steps, you'll definitely get in. And I think the idea is they're trying to build a class that's very diverse and full of very interesting individuals, and they can really kind of see through your motivations for why you're doing something. So for example, I have friends who are like champions at the Chinese yo-yo, or champions at ping pong table tennis, or champions at math competitions. And so there's like a huge variety of different things that you could love and invest yourself in, and not one is necessarily better than the other. And the second thing is that there are a lot of opportunities where you are. So for example, cold emailing and cold calling individuals and just asking them to have a conversation and to ask them for their help, or for, in my case, for science, cold emailing professors and saying, would you be willing to let me take a tour of your lab? Would you be willing to let me work or volunteer at your lab and learn some things? It's something a lot of people don't know they can do, but that it is accessible to them. And so I think it's about sort of opening your eyes and being willing to take a risk and take initiative and find the opportunities for enrichment. And I think it's this self-starting sort of attitude that I found to be very common throughout a lot of my classmates here.
I'll ask a typical question that you might ask of the people in your interviews, but what was the spark that got you going? Well, as a young teenager, I suppose, or maybe even a preteen.
Spark that got me interested in going to Princeton, or just
Princeton and studying science. I mean, in the way that you have, and even set you on the path towards winning the wonderful prize that you did.
Absolutely. So I think one of the characteristics I've seen among some of the most impressive students I have seen across the Ivy Leagues and just in general is a real curiosity. Is really asking I think it's the difference between seeing something and saying, oh, that's cool, and seeing something and saying, oh, that's cool, how does it work? Like, why does it do that? And actively looking for ways you can answer the questions that you have. So for me in high school, it started out with biology class. I was like, this is really interesting, but I feel like all of my learning is from the textbook and is like old news and is kind of dry. And I was interested in, can I actually engage in the process of discovery myself? And that's when I became interested in working in a lab, because doing research yourself is the way that you can ask your own questions and find your own answers.
And very often, kids are going to say, nobody's going to be interested in letting me do that. I'm just a kid.
Yeah. And the surprising thing is, if you have a university in your area, you might get 99 people that say no. One of my friends who actually won the same competition I did 2 years before I won it, he emailed like literally 100 professors, and one professor said, come in for a visit, canceled the meeting the day before, and he said, you know what, I'm going to pretend that I didn't see the email and just show up. So he showed up, and she was like, oh, I canceled the meeting, and he was like, oh, well, can I still have a tour? And by the end of the tour, he kind of talked his way into saying, would you be willing to let me do a trial period of just a month? And he ended up working in the lab for a year and finding some really cool things about cystic fibrosis that won him the competition. So I think it's sort of that idea of persistence and never giving up and saying, you know what, even when people shut doors in my face, I'm going to push at that door and see if there's still any give for me to get in through there.
A terrific message. Now, in addition to all of that you're doing, all that you're doing with science, with this YouTube channel, I guess we could say that you're turning into a budding media star as well. Any thoughts about combining the two? I mean, there are some people out there who try to do that.
Absolutely. So I think one thing, especially in this day and age, that concerns me is when people start to believe that things like alternative facts are okay. And I think that one of the things that's particularly important when we talk about different issues is being able to understand the science behind it. And so I think you're exactly right, that having accurate science communication is crucial, not just for scientists, but for society to flourish as general, and to be educated, and to be able to engage in conversations sort of have a basis as a society for making decisions about what we want to do and where we want to go. And so one thing that I think is really great about science fairs at the high school level is that it trains you to do that. That you should be able to talk about your science not just to other scientists, but to lay people. And I also think one important thing is for scientists not just to learn to communicate it, but also to put their scientific findings in conversation with current topics today. So, for example, not just saying, what can I find out about gene editing? Thinking about, what do my findings about gene editing mean for society? How can it be applied in different ways? What are the ethics of this? Having more conversations about the applications of science in society and how it applies to regular people's lives.
Being able to convey that to regular people who may have misunderstandings.
Yes.
About what this science does mean.
Exactly. There's a really interesting article I read about this scientist who wanted to engineer a certain kind of species that would help eliminate this disease entirely from this particular island, I think it was Nantucket or something. And what he did was he held these town halls where people could just come up to him and ask him anything about his research. And that's pretty new in science, the idea of it being so open access, of allowing non-scientists to challenge and ask you questions about what you're doing. And his message is really to give lay people a question to like engage with scientists in a conversation about the types of research they're doing. And so I think that's one important aspect of science communication as well.
So being a debater here at Princeton and studying microbiology, you have a lot of thoughts about the current political and social climate and how it relates to what you're studying.
Yes, I do. I'm Canadian, so I think I come at it from a slightly different, almost outside perspective. But I think ultimately, the reason why, I'm trying to figure out how to phrase this correctly. I think regardless of what side of the political divide you're on, ultimately there are right and wrong ways to go about things, and I think that we need to have a clear conversation on where we're coming from and why we believe those things. I think there's a lot of talking past each other, and if you want to talk about things that science directly applies to, things like climate change, it's very important to look at the scientific evidence that exists for certain issues and then have a discussion about how we should move forward as a society. So I don't want to become too politicized, but I do think that...
But you do feel an urgency about it, obviously.
Absolutely, absolutely. I do.
So, for those in the audience who might be wondering, what is next for Janelle Tan? What do you say?
It's pretty
open. You're graduating this spring.
I am. It's kind of terrifying. What's next? So, I will be working in Toronto for the next couple of years in sort of the business world. And the idea was, I just really wanted to try something very different. Essentially, the kind of job I'll be doing is I'll be switching projects every couple of months and being exposed to different kinds of industries. And so the idea for me is to learn more about different kinds, what exists in the world, and what I'm interested in from learning about those things. In the long run, I've become very interested in social entrepreneurship, which essentially is the idea that business or for-profit institutions can be a force for social good. So this can come in the form of corporate responsibility, where large companies will donate money to good causes. It can also come in the form of these sort of hybrid organizations like Tom's, where they donate, you know, a pair of shoes for every pair of shoes that they sell. And so I'm very interested, because there's so much money in the private sector right now, how can this private sector be harnessed to create good in the future? And I think that I'm particularly interested into how this applies specifically to health. I'm doing a global health certificate or minor. And so I'm really interested in how we can engineer businesses to specifically tackle problems as they relate to healthcare, particularly in developing countries. And we talk about developing efficient healthcare systems or improving supply chains when you think about pharmaceuticals or different medical supplies. And so hopefully, once I've learned about that, I will probably go for further education of some kind, whether it's business school or medical school.
Sounds like the kind of person who's needed at this point in time. For more information, where can people go to see your videos and learn more about you?
So you can go to the National Leadership Academy's website, and then I will be also speaking at the Congress this year in June. And then as well, I also have my own blog. So it's janellehmtan.wordpress.com.
Terrific. And it's H-M
and then T-A-M.
H-M-T-A-M. Janelle, thanks for taking the time with us.
Thank you so much, Fred. It was a pleasure to talk to you today.